I'm terrible about that. I was really taking notes with Frank last night. He left cards on everybody's chairs, and I was like, man, this is like Oprah Winfrey show. And I don't even have, I'm one of those people that that I really need to up my social media game. And I keep saying that. I've been saying that for 10 years, so maybe this year.
I think it's going away. I think it's kind of a fad. I don't think you have to worry
like
about
rap music, man. It's going away.
It's going away. That stuff's, it's not going to hang around. How I was able to find out you were a legit hit songwriter was one of the top hits on your search was your discography, and that is lengthy and filled with names I definitely had heard of. So I was like, well, okay, Lisa Carver definitely exists, and she's definitely a hit songwriter.
Well, I will tell you, there is a fascinating woman named Lisa Crystal Carver. That is not me. I am far less interesting than Lisa Crystal Carver. She's an interesting cat. But I went to a gig one time, and they did not dig deep enough. And they thought I was Lisa Crystal Carver, and it was Tom Bresch, Mike Loudermilk, and Lisa Crystal Carver. And people were not coming to buy my CD because they thought I was her. And I was like, I need to do something about my social media presence. I was going to change my name to Carver. Do you think that would clear it up? I mean, you know more about this stuff.
I don't know anything. I do know.
Well, any advice would be welcome as far as how to get a presence without being confused for my far more interesting Lisa Carver.
Well, you made a career. You know, you're obviously doing great in life, no matter what. And you're telling me how you had a little bit non-conventional route through the music business. So you're going non-conventional. Where you're kind of off social media. You have been doing this for a long time. Do you want to talk a little bit about your path and how that has worked out for you?
Yeah. Well, no, actually it makes me feel very vulnerable, but I'm pushing through, learning to be great. My mother, Jenny Lynn Carver, was a gospel singer. I was born in Charleston, South Carolina. She and my Aunt Betty and my grandmother had a huge trio, a gospel group. And so I grew up listening to gospel music, and then my dad was into all the old school country, the Hank and Willie, you know, all those guys. And when I was 6 years old, my mother was dragged into this very interesting religious cult called The Move. And so at 10 years old, I moved to a little island called Chickagoff Island in Juneau, Alaska. And a guy named Sam Fife was the leader of The Move. And it makes so much sense now that I realized later when I Googled him and I thought, oh, that wasn't a weird dream, that actually happened. I found out he was a frustrated / failed country western singer-songwriter. And if you Google Sam Fife, he told us we would all live forever if we did what he said. And the next summer, he crashed his plane in Guatemala, and he passed away. And I was like, cool, can we go home now? Apparently, he was a sacrificial lamb. So anyway, this 5 years that I spent on that commune, honestly, outside music was not allowed. So I would steal my dad's country cassettes. That was like contraband on the commune. And I would listen to that, and I just thought, man, if I can just get to Nashville, I just want to be Christofferson. And so 5 years on that commune with some of the really most horrific songwriting I've ever heard. They had their own music, and bless their hearts, you know, because they were trying. But it really made me want to be a songwriter, to kind of erase those tapes, maybe. So I moved to Nashville when I had just turned 20, and I knew no one. I just knew I loved songs and that I had a lot of healing I needed to do. And horses and songs have always been my healers and kindred spirits. So I got to Nashville and I kind of forgot about it. I got married and had babies, and I kind of kept an eye on the songwriting community. And then I got signed. I met Anthony Smith and just a bunch of cool people at the old Broken Spoke. And I got signed to Sony and Big Alpha with Laura Stroud. And I started being put in rooms to co-write, which was really hard for me. It was not something that came natural. And I found out I really love that with the right people. And if it was the wrong person, it was like a bad date. You're kind of like, oh, gotta go, emergency at home, you know. But when it gelled, it was rocking, and it was beautiful. And somebody that, especially melodically, I feel like I'm a lyric person. I love that. But I really love when I get in with like a melody writer or something. So I started honing skills and trying to play the game. And my only regret there is I feel like I was so excited that somebody liked me. I was like, yes, somebody likes my music, that I started to kind of I was trying too hard to please the publisher rather than do what I do, you know? And so I think my only regret is I should have written a lot more alone. I started co-writing everything. And then you kind of forget, it's like, oh, how do I do this alone? And I do think my best songs were written alone.
Okay.
Yeah.
Do you have a strength? Do you feel like you're a first verse or a chorus, or when you were kind of leaning, having to co-write a lot or preferring to co-write, did you have a spot where you felt like I can really shine here?
You know, for me, it's different every time.
Okay.
Sometimes I would bring in a guitar and start playing something, and my favorite way, I mean, in Nashville, a lot of times you sit down at 9:30, 10 in the morning, and somebody has their hook book, you know, or they're like, I want to write this title, or and especially if I don't know someone, my favorite way is just to make them some coffee and sit and talk about their life. What made you mad yesterday? What made you happy? You know, who are you? And I've always loved, because when you start opening up and making it a safe place for people to talk, they start telling you. And that's where songs come from that I really love, is when you connect to somebody's heart instead of just a catchy hook or whatever. So that's the way I write. I also did a song last night that was very scary for me to do. Thankfully, someone, Brother Mike, requested it, and I did a song called Bullet, which is... Thank you. To this day, it's still my favorite because I got out of the way and I literally asked the river of song, I call it. I don't know where it comes from. It's not me. I'm not that smart. And I just asked for it, and I swear I woke up at my kitchen table and went, you know, it's like when you just let yourself be a channel. That's when I call them the God songs happen, you know? And I'm not really good at crafting like hooky stuff. People say, oh, I love how you held on to your integrity in Nashville. And I was like, no, really, I just wasn't very good at it. I would love to pretend I was that, you know. So it's always different for me.
Okay.
And I love getting in a room with people who don't push it and rush it. You know, I sat down with one young cat who, just a sweetheart, but he had just been on one of those shows, not The Voice, something like that. And he goes, I am here to write mega hits. And I was like, oh, cool, rock on, man. Let's see what you got, you know? I was like, I don't know how to go. Every time you get in a room, it's a blank sheet of paper. I'm old school. Everybody says it's a blank computer screen now. But for me, it's a blank sheet of paper. And you're at the same level, and you're trying your best to put words and emotions into a piece of art. To me, that's what I want it to feel like,
yeah.
You know, and it can be happy or sad, or, you know, I have a little saucy song or two. I'm not opposed to those either.
Do you want to sing us one of those? Do you want to sing us one of those saucy songs?
Oh, I don't know. It's too early for, is it too early for saucy?
No!
All right. Anybody have a pick?
Woo!
All right. Thank you, man. All right. Well, is this... Y'all hear that?
No.
Okay, I apologize for anyone that I might offend with this. I do that a lot. I'm writing sweeter songs that my mom approves of, but back in the day I was a bit rebellious. I don't know why I felt like pushing back on the commune years. So I would write things that mom would go, oh honey, that's nice, but when are you going to write some sweet songs? She probably said that after hearing this one. I was talking last night about watching Jerry Springer and seeing this story. And this is really, wait, hold on, not that loud. There we go. Is that okay? All right. Has anybody been drinking?
Yeah.
Oh, good. That makes me feel better. And Pearl Jam, I'm more Willie and Merle. Boy, you are barely a man, but then again, I'm hardly a girl. I know we're gonna raise a few eyebrows. Ooh, sugar, you know I'm used to that. First time your lips touched my lip, redefined the generation gap with. Your mother. And your friends seem to be cool with it. It's mine that's been kind of mean. The other day your brother said he digs it, cause girls your age don't cook or clean. I said something about Watergate. You turned around and asked me, like, Richard who? Kissed your little cheek, yeah. Like a lover, I gotta take a screw, yeah. I'm old enough to be your lover. You're finally old enough to get home. I'm old enough to be your lover. I'll break it to my kid, you don't wanna break it to your mama. True love transcends the boundaries of time. Honey, I'm at my peak, you're in your prime. When I'm in your arms, I do not care what they think, that I'm too old for you, and you're too young to
drink
or spank.
Saucy song. 11:50 a.m. I love it. That's great.
Thank you for the pick.
This guitar is so cool. We were talking about this a little bit. Can you tell the audience a little bit about your instrument here?
Oh my gosh. This is way more guitar than I deserve. I intend to take some lessons and get my chops up. I dated an incredible man, a guy named Tom Bresch, who was the son of a guy named Merle Travis. Merle Travis wrote bum, 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 bum. 16 tons. So actually Merle Travis apparently had a big hand in the design of this headstock, and I've only broken one string on stage in all the years I've played, and that was at Tin Pan South in Nashville. I had to follow Big Al Anderson. You can't hear, love. Can we turn it up? He's cupping his ear. I want you happy, honey. Can you hear better? Is that better?
It's a young girl.
What is your name? What is your name?
He still can't hear.
He still can't hear. Yeah. If you're asking him his name. Yeah. What is it? Wally?
Yeah.
Wally, thank you for being here. I'm very sensitive to cupping because I do the same thing because of all my years around loud amps and stuff. I'm looking into one of those, man. Wally, thank you. Can you hear now? Is that a little better? All right, love. Wally's happy, so I'm happy. So where was I?
Your guitar.
Oh, yeah,
Merle
my
Travis.
Guitar. Merle Travis. So anyway, I was following Bill, Big Al Anderson. Y'all ever heard of him?
Oh,
he's
yeah.
a badass monster. And of course, he's framing away, just, and I had just written with somebody that morning, and I said, man, I've never broken a string on stage because of this Merle Travis headstock. And I got all hyped up following Big Al, and I, first song, first verse, boom, I lost my low E. But that's the only time in all these years it's happened. It's a luthier out of Grass Valley, California, named Harvey Leach, who is just a genius. He does all the inlay and all that work for Martin. He's an amazing, amazing artist, Harvey Leach, and a good dude. So Bresch knew I was from Alaska, and he had the blue-eyed wolf, and I told him a story. Told him a story one day about being 12 years old on that commune, and I was very kind of on my own. Those were my happiest moments there. And it was an Alaska, beautiful full moon, and I brought my ice skates out. And I'm skating on this little frozen patch of pond, and around me is miles of snow that had been a little bit melted, and it froze hard at night, and it was just glistening. And then there were purple snow-capped mountains, and then the bay. The moon was shining on the waves of the bay, and I said, it's the most, I knew at 12 years old, this is the most stunning thing I will ever see. And it's true, it's still. So he had that engraved by Harvey Leach on the headstock. Bear claw spruce. I will say there was a little soft shell case accident, and the body had to be rebuilt, and I'm still trying to bond with this version of spirit. So we're working on that, but this is my girl. This is what I'll be playing when I'm 80 years old, if I'm lucky enough.
So, interesting. You're from Alaska. You've written some songs with Jewel.
Oh my God! Yes, Jewel Kilcher. Y'all, who will save your soul? Well, I have a buddy in Nashville named Liz Rose, and she wrote, I think, like 8 songs on that first Taylor Swift album. And, you know, so we both went from getting our cars repossessed to her. She's like, oh, okay, yeah, that's not my life anymore. She's doing all right, Miss Liz Rose. So she and I wrote this song. What was it called? Till It Feels Like Cheating. We wrote it, forgot about it, and John Rich was cutting a record on Jewel, her first country album. And she cut that song, and it was the first song she ever cut that she hadn't written.
Oh, wow.
And it was so cool. So she ended up inviting me out to her ranch with a few of the big songwriters, and I was so excited because I just love her, man. She is not only drop-dead gorgeous, she's so smart. I'm trying not to cuss, sorry. She's so smart, and she's hilarious. And she was just this beautiful hostess. And I fell in love with her and her husband at the time, Ty, who was a big deal bull rider or something. And I loved him because I saw these big mounds of dirt. And she knew I was a horse lover and I was gonna go pet a horse. And she goes, no, Carver, do not approach those horses. Those are the horses that Ty rescues that are retired Bronx. And rather than going to be shipped off for slaughter, he lets them hang out here until they pass. And I was like, yes, these are my people. So I was so excited to write with her, and all the Nashville writers were going in the room. I was last, one of the last to write. And, so they were going and trying to write her big radio single, you know? And I started going over interviews, and I was like, what am I gonna write with this woman who I dearly love? And in all of her interviews, she would say, well, you know, I'm my father's daughter. And I was like, okay. So I walked in and I said, this is gonna be a big ask, but I wanna write the song that your fans ask for 20 years from now and the story of your family. And so we wrote Father's Daughter. And she was just awesome. I mean, she kind of looked at me like, oh, this is gonna be intense. And she opened her mouth and started singing and those lyrics poured out. It was kind of one of those deals where I felt like, oh, okay, I shouldn't even have my name on this song because she just let it flow and I play guitar. And when I left Nashville, I kind of had a crash and burn couple of years where a lot of personal tragedies happened, and I just thought, I've got to go run away to the desert somewhere where I can heal or I'm not going to make it. And I was about 6 months at my friend's house in Bosque del Apache, and I got a text. And one of my big regrets leaving Nashville was I never got a Dolly Parton cut. And I was like, man, I love me some Dolly. And so Jewel sends me a text and she goes, Carver, look who I'm in the studio with, cutting Father's Daughter. And it was Dolly Parton. Yeah. So I just love her. And I lost touch with a lot of lot of people in the process of kind of trying to find my healing, my good space again. But she's someone who I have on, you know, I wouldn't say a pedestal, because we know those are not fair places to put people, but she is in the highest esteem and the sweetest spot in my heart. She's an amazing human.
Could I be so bold as to ask you to play us that song?
Oh wow. I can try it. Okay, let me get a little water. Everybody good?
Yeah.
It's always a weird mix of music and therapy with me. Sorry, y'all. That'll be $150. Okay, I lost my father a couple years ago, so this might, we'll get through it. She stepped off of the boat to see flowers in his hand. The man she would marry was as hard as the mountains. She raised his babies in an old log cabin. And soon I'd be another star in the family's constellation, in the land of the midnight sun, searching for gold. I am my father's daughter. He has his mother's eyes. I am the product of his sacrifice. I am the accumulation of the dreams of generations, and their stories live in me like holy water. I am my father's daughter. My daddy raised me in an old log cabin, and he sang to me the songs his mother sang to him in honky-tonks and crowded bars, just him and me and that old guitar. He passed down a legacy wrapped up in a melody. I carry on searching for gold. I am my father's daughter. I have his eyes. I am the product of such sacrifice. I am the accumulation of the dreams of generations, and their stories live in me like holy water. I am my father's daughter. And every time I step on stage, all the music finds me. I don't need gold to remind me. I am my father's daughter. I have his eyes, and I'm the product of his sacrifice. I am the accumulation of the dreams of generations, and their stories live in me like holy water. I am my father's daughter. And my father's daughter.
That was beautiful. Miss Lisa Carver, everybody. Thank you so much for coming out.
All right. Thank you guys. Bless y'all.
All right. Thank you so much.